हेलो, गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन।
गुड मॉर्निंग मैम।
सो वी हैव अमंग अस प्रोफेसर अरुंधति भाले कुंभारिकर मैम, हु विल बी कंडक्टिंग अ सेशन ऑन इंटेलेक्चुअल प्रॉपर्टी राइट्स। सो आई विल जस्ट गिव हर अ ब्रीफ इंट्रोडक्शन एज व्हाट शी इज एंड व्हाट शी हैज परस्यूड। सो शी हैज कंप्लीटेड हर LLM इन क्रिमिनल लॉ एंड कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल लॉ फ्रॉम बाबा साहेब अम्बेडकर मराठवाड़ा यूनिवर्सिटी औरंगाबाद। She is currently working as an assistant professor in Lokmanya Tilak Law College, Pune. Apart from teaching experience of 5.5 years, she also has a work experience of 7.5 years. And she is also currently pursuing her PhD in law, JJTU University, Jaipur. So we welcome you, ma'am. And may I please request you to start the session? Thank you.
Yeah. Good morning, everyone. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Good morning, everyone. Myself, Arundhati Bhale, and thanks for inviting me for such a wonderful webinar, which is the topic of webinar is the IPR, and the orientation I'm going to give you on the general or basic principles of IPR, and we will try to focus on Copyright Act. Okay. So first of all, when we listen to word IPR, which is called as intellectual property right, so we have to understand what is the origin of this particular word, or what is the origin of this particular concept, that is intellectual property right. So we are aware about that there are two types of properties, are there like physical property, and another one is the intellectual property that we are going to discuss about. So physical property is a property which we can touch, which we can feel, but on the other hand, another one is the intellect or intellectual property. Okay, so in physical property, there can be a car, there can be a plot, or anything else which can be touched, which can be feel, that is called as a tangible one. But on the other hand, when it comes to intellectual property, if I'm singing any song, that cannot be feel, that cannot be touched. So these kind of things are intellectual properties. It means if I have a right of way, that right of way cannot be touched, that right of way cannot be feel. Only what we can do is we can use it, we can access that particular right, that is right of way. So these rights are intangible one. And this is why it is called as the intellectual property. So the most noticeable difference between intellectual property and other forms of property is that intellectual property is intangible, that is, it cannot be defined. So that is the basic thing or the basic origin of intangible property. So intellect is a mind. Intellect is a creativity. And what is property? Property is basically asset. Property is a bundle of right. When I say property, it has a very vast meaning. So what is bundle of right property has? In this bundle of right, we can possess the property. It means I can use the property. I can sell the property. Property can be mortgaged. Property can be destroyed, and property can be changed. So all these are the rights which property has. And that's why we called it as a bundle of right. When I owned it, obviously I have right, I can destroy it, I can use it. So everything which is there in that bundle of right is a property. So After this, we can understand the property is not only word, but it has very vast meaning behind this particular word. Okay, IPR is the property which is the creation of human mind, which is the creation of intellect, which is the creation of human mind, that is intellectual property. So this is basically the basic theme behind the intellectual property, and we all are aware about the constitutional provisions regarding the expression and free speech and expression. So obviously when I start speaking on intellectual property, copyright will come on first rank. So copyright is basically given to literary work or the artistic work, or any particular speech or book, whatever like this. So it all these covers under the free speech constitutional provision, or which we can say as a fundamental right. Okay, so over here we will try to understand all concepts which covered under intellectual property one by one. So what is copyright? Copyright basically exclusive right. Copyright is exclusive right to commercially exploit the property. If I owned any particular book, so obviously as the author of that book, I have right that I can print my book. I have right that I can publish that particular book in market. Okay, along with this, what I can do? I can sell it. I can make new version of that particular book. I can make new edition, or I can just destroy that book. So I am owner of that particular property. It means all these rights are vested in the word property, and I am owner, right? So now author can transfer his right. It means if I am owner and I am just possessing all the bundle of rights, I can transfer it, obviously. So author can transfer his right to the publisher. For this transfer, author gets payment as a royalty from publisher. Now, what are the another types of property, or what is exactly copyright, that we will try to understand. Copyright basically related with the creativity. Okay, it means copyright is not based on the knowledge which we have. Copyright is basically given for creativity, that is making movie or making any song, or it can be given to the author for any particular book which is written by him, or any art. Okay, so we have we all are aware about PK movie and OMG movie, right? Both movies are based on blind faith on God, right? But both movies are different. Both movies are different from each other. It means it is based on creativity of mind. Such creativity of mind has to be protected as of right. So whatever knowledge you have, if you succeed to extract that particular knowledge or such knowledge in a creative way, then you can get copyright. So it means copyright cannot be given, or copyright is not basically for your knowledge, but it is for creativity. It is for the creation, and that particular creation has to be unique, right? Another one is, another type of intellectual property is a patent. Now, patent basically is given to the inventions. Patent basically given to the processes, that is formulas, okay? So generally, patents are given to the medicines, okay? So now what is the difference between invention and discovery? There is a difference. Discovery is whatever is there in existence, and you are putting these things in front of the people is discovery. Now, what is invention then? Invention basically is a formula. Invention basically is a process. If person is inventing something new, if person is trying to invent something new, which is not basically familiar or which is not in existence, that is invention. So when person invented any particular drug, when a person invented any particular process, that is patent. Then patent can be granted to the person. Okay. Now, what is trademark? Trademark is little different from this these two. That trademark is based on the sign. Trademark is based on the symbols. Trademark is based on the tagline, logo, and abbreviations. Like you might be aware about the Adidas shoes or Nike shoes. So that particular symbol has been, that particular symbol, actually they opted for the trademark. So these are the difference between these main intellectual property types. So apart from this, what are the types, another types of intellectual property we have? First one, we have seen copyright, then we have seen patent also, trademark. Apart from these, industrial designs also, geographical indications, then layout design of integrated circuits, then plant varieties and data protection. So all these are the types of intellectual property. So one by one, we will try to differentiate these type of properties. So property comes into existence because of intellect, right? So first one, that is copyright. Under copyright, literary works are fall. Literary work means it can be book, it can be movie, it can be musical work, it can be painting also, or drama or software. So if I am author of any XYZ book, so and if I opted for copyright, then what is basically the protection the Copyright Act is going to give me? So the protection is a lifetime of the author, that is me over here, lifetime of the author plus 60 years. Okay, it means after my death, my legal heirs or my legal representative, they will enjoy the royalty. So this type of royalty will be given to my legal heirs. Okay, so copyright is lifetime of author plus 60 years. Okay, apart from this, copyright can be given to the software also. Copyright can be given to the drama also. Okay, so these all these falls under the literary work. Now what about design then? What is industrial design? Design can be fashion design. We are all aware about Manish Malhotra and his team. They are well known for their designs, that is fashion design. Or are you aware about the automobile designing courses? Yes, we are. So car designing also falls under the industrial design. Then bike designing or product designing is also one of the course which we can opt for, that is the shapes of bottle. Or shoe designing also one of the course where we can find the different design shoes, that is Nike or Adidas. So shoe designing also one of the course, and jewelry designing is also one of the course. Every design has a commercial value. Okay, and that's why, because of that commercial value, the product is getting sold, and that's why they are getting paid for. Okay, and then another is invention or patent. We have seen trademark. We have seen, what about trade secrets? Trade secrets is a little different from the patent and the trademark. Over here, it is not basically deals with the design or the sign. It deals with the formulas. For example, if we have taken one example of Coca-Cola or Pepsi, they have their own formula, and that formula is a secret formula, but they have not opted for the patent. Then what they have done? They opted or they registered themselves for the trade secret. Okay, trade secret, first of all, when person is just trying to apply for trade secret, then initially they will get 10 years protection. And after every 10 years, that trade secret can be renewed. It means this particular trade secret has infinite monopoly. That is why it is called as a trade secret. What about integrated circuit? We all are using smartphone. Someone of you may have a OnePlus or Oppo or Samsung. Behind the screen of our smartphone, there is a circuit, and obviously this circuit is not same. So every smartphone company, they have opted for the registration under integrated circuit. And what kind of protection they can obtain for? That is for 20 years. So their monopoly is only for 20 years. Period, after 20 years of period, that particular integrated circuit will be a public property. It means it can be used by anyone else. Okay. What about copyright that we have seen, the life of author plus 60 years? Then design. Design initially, if person is trying to register or he wants to get protection for design under Design Act, then initially he can get protection of 10 years. After renewal, 5 years. It means 10 plus 5 is 15 years. So once 15 years are over, that particular design, that design can be generic design and it can be a public property. Same like patent. Patent or the period of patent is a 20 years. It can be given for an invention. Okay, after 20 years, it would be a generic property or it would be a public property. Might be many of you have seen generic medicals. So all over there in generic medicals, all the medicines which basically they lost their patent, all the medicines are kept over there or generally kept in the generic medicine shop. That is basically the patent. Okay. Trademark, initially person can obtain or person can get 10 years protection, and that 10 years protection can be renewed after every 10 years. It means protection is infinite protection. Same with geographical indications. Basmati rice is also one of the geographical indication type, and that can be renewed after every 10 years. It means obviously geographical indications are also they have opted for infinite protection under this particular law. Now we are just talking about the periods and the types and what is mean by patent and geographical indication. But before that, we have to understand these laws. What are the basis of these laws? Why these laws has been existed and what is the basic? Or is there any concrete base to just develop and evolve this kind of laws? So answer is yes, we have. IPR or intellectual property right is basically based on few theories. Okay, these theories are natural right theory. This theory is a personality theory and another one is a utilitarian theory. So we will try to understand theories one by one, just in 2 minutes. Natural right theory basically invented by Locke, and that's why it is known as a Locke theory. Okay, so a person has a natural right to the fruits of his labor. It means if person try to prepare anything or if he is try to work on any particular thing, obviously naturally he has right on that particular thing. Everyone has a property right over the labor. So this should be recognized, that particular labor which he or she has been done, that has to be recognized as his or her property. Whether that property is a tangible which can be touched or feel, or whether the property is intangible which cannot be feel or which cannot be touched, but he should have the right on that particular property. What about personality theory? Personality theory, basically it is propounded by the Hegel and it is named as Hegel's theory also. Work is the personal expression of authors. Whatever work has been done by the author is his personal expression or inventor's own thought, right? So when inventor has his own thought or has his own expression, he should have the right to decide when and how his work to be produced in front of the public, right? So it safeguards individual's freedom of speech and freedom of expression. That is personality theory. What about utilitarian theory? Utilitarian theory basically speaks about the social benefits or socially beneficial theory. Intellectual property right exists because it creates beneficial and better economic effects on the society. Society has to be care about its creator. It means any particular book has been written by XYZ person, then it is a duty of the society to protect his rights, right? So the utilitarian theory basically talks about society should care about its creators because the ultimate beneficiary is the society itself. This is how the concept of intellectual property comes into existence. So we can understand that the intellectual property concept or the intellectual property right is based on these three theories. That is natural theory, another one is a utilitarian theory and personality theory. Okay, now come to the just we will try to just move further. That is another concept, that is in convention and treaties. Now it is understood that because of these theory, intellectual property rights has been they come into existence. But apart from that, what about the if XYZ person has been applied for patent in the year 1800 or in 1900, so whether that particular protection can be granted to him at that time, or other person can whether same protection can be granted to him? So yes, it has to be, because the basic or the fundamental concept behind giving protection is protection has to be given in every nation or all the nation who are the members of that particular convention. So we will try to understand 3-4 main conventions which basically uplift or which basically safeguard the intellectual property rights. So first one is a Paris Convention. Paris Convention basically it has been conducted in the year 1883. And what is basically the motto behind this Paris Convention is same protection in all nations has to be granted to the person or the author. Another one is right of priority. It means if in 2-3 nations the research work is going on the same topic or the same subject, so who will come first and the person who will apply first, that means first come first serve, that is that has to be given to the person who is applying at applying first. That is Paris Convention. And apart from this, common rules of filing, common rules of registration and etc. has to be given by Paris Convention in the year 1883. Okay, now we will move further to Bern Convention. Bern Convention basically deals about the literary work and artistic work. On the other hand, which we have discussed earlier, that is Paris Convention, it deals with the industrial property only. That is the difference between these two conventions. And Bern Convention basically conducted in the year 1886. But Bern Convention is basically given to the literary work and artistic work. And first one, that is Paris Convention, is a industrial property work. That is the difference. In Bern Convention, protection of right of author has been given. Along with this, author this type of protection has been given to the author, musician or poet or painter. So this kind of protection has to be given has been given to these kind of people. Then third comes, that is WIPO, which is called as a WIPO. And WIPO has been conducted in the year 1967. Okay, after Paris and Bern Convention, the need or the requirement arose that both the convention has to be get united, and that's why the WIPO treaty basically comes into existence, and they replace Paris Convention and the Bern Convention, and now the only known treaty is a WIPO treaty, and the headquarter of the WIPO is in Geneva, Switzerland. And now the WIPO treaty is basically important part of the United Nations also from 1974. After WIPO Convention, TRIPS Agreement come. Now what is TRIPS Agreement? TRIPS. TRIPS is one of the most important agreement of a WIPO, that WIPO and WTO, that is World Trade Organization. After WIPO or the after TRIPS agreement, that is Marrakesh Treaty has been come in 2013, when TRIPS agreement has started from post January 1995, and then Marrakesh Treaty. So, but over here the main focus is on TRIPS agreement. TRIPS agreement covers all the types of intellectual property right, that is copyright and related right, then trademarks, then patent and variety of patent, then variety of plant, sorry, then geographical indication, industrial design, then layout of integrated circuits, trade secret that we have discussed earlier. So all these rights, all these intellectual property rights are covered under TRIPS treaty only. So what is basically the motto behind the TRIPS treaty? TRIPS treaty's motto is common set of rules for protection of intellectual property right has to be established in every nation who are the member of that particular treaty. So for that, domestic act and remedies has to be made or has to be changed according to the provisions of the TRIPS agreement. By signing TRIPS agreement, Indian government made major amendments and major changes into the IPR laws and patent law basically has come into existence, and 1970 law has been replaced by 2005 law, and Copyright Act 2012 is also come into existence. Now, according to these particular laws, what is copyright and neighboring right then? Copyright gives creator of a literary work, creator of a dramatic work, musical work and artistic work along with the cinematography or films and sound recording exclusively right over or exclusively right to reproduce or to perform or to translate or to communicate their work in front of the public. But it doesn't mean that they by their own going to do all these things. It means if I am a filmmaker and I have created one film, so whether I am going to keep that particular film in front of the public, so answer is no. So what they have to do for that, they just transfer their right to other organization, that is broadcast reproduction right. Okay, so broadcasters and performance right are called as a neighboring right. Copyright we have seen, along with copyright, that is neighboring right which broadcaster has, which performer has. Okay, they are attached right to original work. This is how copyright and the neighboring right come into existence. Okay, so though the creator of the particular work owns the copyright initially, but it might be sold, that particular right might be sold, or that particular right can be assigned to someone else by license, and that particular license basically based on the mutual agreement and the terms and condition of that particular mutual agreement. It can be given wholly, it can be given partly also. So these type of license or the assignment can be given another person or the broadcaster for what? For they, that can be given for what actually? For commercial filmmaker, it can be given to the commercial filmmaker, it can be given to the publishers or recording studios, or it apart from this, it can be given to someone else who could exploit the work commercially. Okay, and by exploiting the work commercially, he can get the profit and the benefit. But over here, what is the consequence of this particular agreement or this particular regime is, copyright often benefits commercial interest more than the individual author. It means I am author and you is a commercial, you has a commercial interest. So over here, you can get more profit than the me. However, it depends entirely on the terms and the agreement between the creator of work and the exploiter of the work. So this is how we can just understand the concept of copyright, which has been given under the Copyright Act 2012. So what is the subject matter of copyright? That is also important one. Over here, section 5 basically speaks about the subject matter of copyright. So subject matter of copyright and neighboring right act 2006 and 2012 speaks about work that are eligible for copyright protection. These are literary and artistic work. This can be scientific work also and derivative work also. So under literary and artistic work, or under literary and artistic and scientific work, there can be that can be article, or that can be books, that can be pamphlets, that can be lectures also, or speeches also. So all these kind of or all these kind of work or similar work can be fall under literary work, or it can be dramatic work, musical work, cinematographic work, or computer programs also, or electronic data bank also. It falls under the literary or artistic scientific work. Then next come derivative work. What is derivative work? Derivative work means work which is already there in existence, but it is basically reintroduced, that is translations of any particular book, or adaptations and any kind of transformation from pre-existing work is called as a derivative work. Collection of pre-existing works like encyclopedia, etc., all these are derivative works which falls under the section 5 of the Copyright Act. Now we have seen that what are the work fall under section 5, but whether limitations are there on this particular right, whether exceptions are there to this particular right, the answer is yes, it has limitation, it has exceptions also. So under limitation, in order to maintain an appropriate balance between the interest of the copyright holder and the user of a protected work, the law allows certain limitations along with the exceptions. It means it allows that the protected work may be used without authorization of copyright holder. How it is? That we will try to understand. If further allows the use of original work without payment of compensation. So we will try to understand how it can be done. What are the limitation on this particular thing? One limitation is the duration or term of copyright protection. Copyright does not extend indefinitely. It is not given for infinite period. It is for a limited period, and that limited period we have already discussed. That is lifetime of the author plus 60 years. Okay. After his lifetime, after his death, royalty can be given to the legal heirs or the legal representative of the author. As a general rule, Section 6 of the Copyright Act says that copyright exists for lifetime and 60 years, that we have seen. And at the end of the copyright term, or at the end of the copyright works, copyright term, that particular work enters the public domain. That work enter into the public domain and may be used freely. It can be used freely. Now, it cannot infringe any person's or author's copyright. Okay. After discussing these limitations, we will try to understand one provision of law, that is Section 34, which speaks about purpose of copyright and commercial use of it. Certain uses of copyrighted work do not infringe the copyright holder's copyright. Why so? Such as it is used for non-profit or educational purposes. If any particular artistic work or literary work is used for educational purpose, if it is used for academic purpose, and if it is used for non-profit purpose, then copyright is not infringed. Okay. Then if it is used for private purpose, if it is used for reporting of current event, then also copyright is not infringed. So likewise, we have seen the quotation in short form, or it can be used as a compatible with fair use, so it can be used. Along with these limitations or exceptions, we have to discuss a few more. That is, normally An author or the copyright holder can exclude unauthorized parties from reproducing or performing or publishing or displaying, or if they are making adaptation in work for which the author has received copyright. However, the Copyright Act allows certain instances what would otherwise be the unauthorized use of work by creating exception into the copyright that we have discussed. What if the copyright is getting infringed, or what is mean by infringement of copyright? Copyright infringement is the use or the use of that particular work or production of copyright protected material without the permission of the copyright holder. That is infringement of copyright. Copyright infringement means that the right offered to the copyright holder, such as exclusive use of work for a set of period of time, are being breached by a person who is not a copyright holder, or by a person who is a third party. As a general matter, copyright infringement occurs when a copyright work is reproduced, or when copyright work is distributed, or when copyright work is performed publicly, when copyright work is displayed publicly for commercial purpose. So these kind of things, so if permission has been obtained by the owner or the copyright holder, then it cannot be called as an infringement, but it can be called as a license. But over here, the permission has not been taken from the copyright holder. That's why it is infringement. So where there is right, there is remedy, right? So where intellectual property has been provided you protection, if protection is there, then obviously it has to be give remedies also. So answer is yes, we have remedies for this kind of infringement of copyright. So these remedies basically divided into two types of remedies. These are civil remedies, and another one is a criminal remedy. Now, what is civil remedies we have if some person or the third person infringe copyright? So we have three kinds of remedies. First one is injunction. Might be you have heard the word injunction. What is mean by injunction? Injunction means to stop. Injunction means to restrain person from doing that particular act. Okay. It means if person is continuously infringing that particular work, the injunction order can be taken from the court, and after taking injunction order, person has to stop doing this particular thing. Apart from injunction, another one is impounding and disposition of infringing article. If a court satisfies that this particular XYZ person has infringed any particular person's copyright, and if he is in possession of that work, then that has to be taken from the person. It is the duty of the court to impound and dispose of the material, and it has to be given to the copyright holder. And third one is a damages. Third one is a compensation. It means whatever profit the person has been received by doing copyright infringement, that has to be given to the copyright holder, along with the damages. Damages, it means compensation. And what type of compensation, or what will be the quantum of compensation, it is absolutely a discretionary power of the court. It is called as a statutory damages also. So all these comes under civil remedies. So what kind of civil remedies we have discussed over here? Injunction. It means first of all, the person has to be restrained from doing this thing. Then if he is in possession of this kind of work, that has to be taken from him, and compensation has to be given along with the profit which he has obtained from that infringement. Okay. Apart from this civil remedy, we have criminal remedies also. Now, when word criminal comes, criminal means along with fine, imprisonment is also there, but that can differ. what kind of work or what kind of copyright has been infringed. So that is basically a different thing. So this is how I explained what is copyright, what are the types of IPR. We have just taken overview. Because the short of time, I am not able to explain each and everything in very detail. But I tried to explain, and I have given macro view of IPR and types of IPR. And if you have any query regarding the duration and anything else, you can just you can ask me. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. That was really a nice lecture, very extensive, and I hope that our students will have, you know, made notes and gained something out of it. So I thank you for coming, and if anyone has any questions, please, you are free to ask, ma'am. We still have 5 minutes. You can raise your hands if you want to ask.
No worries. If you don't have a question right now, you can come to me, to law department, and you can ask me if you have any, if you have other questions also regarding patent and trademark along with copyright.
Ma'am, no worries at all.
Okay. I guess then everyone is welcome to, you know, visit the department anytime.
Yes, definitely. Surely you can come. Yeah.
So with this, I thank you all for joining us. I thank you, ma'am, for giving out this session for our students. And you are again free to come whenever you want. We'll be here.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thanks for inviting me. Thank you, Swarali ma'am. Thank you, Devi Rupa ma'am. And thank you, Gitali ma'am also. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity. Thank you so much.
Okay, bye. Bye, everyone. See you tomorrow for your third session.